was that fun?
Yeah.
Right, yeah. I mean, there's a smile, and you're just trying to out-generous each other. Remember at the very beginning, you might have thought, well, that's just a throwaway line. And I said that a lot of times, generosity gives you more than you expect. You guys had fun. Right? And there was something about giving generously that's like fun. How many of you have ever given anybody else a gift, or you bought a gift for somebody else, and you're like, oh, man, I can't wait for them to get this gift, because I know that this is like, right? I know that this is a really cool gift, and it's like they have this big smile on their face when they open it, but you're like, you have got almost as big a smile on your face when you open it, because there is a joy in giving. There's a joy in giving, because that's God's heart. When God gave himself for us, there was pain that cost him. It cost God everything he had. But I believe that on that cross, as Jesus is silent and he's thinking about us, there's joy in his heart as he's thinking about us. And remember, God wants us to get his heart. So when we talk about how do we make these changes so that it's not natural for us to give, and it's certainly not natural for us to give generously. So how do we make those changes? Let me give you some places to start today. If you haven't written some things down, maybe now would be a really good point to do that. Malia, you want to turn that sound up just a little bit back there? Here's the first thing. The first thing has to do with remember. Because you got to remember that change starts with God. If you try to do this yourself, if you say, you're hyped up today and say, oh man, that was fun. Giving generously, I understand it now. There's joy in that, and it's after God's heart. I can do this, and you try to do it yourself, you're eventually going to crash and burn. Because it's not natural for us. And so giving starts with God, and the way to do that is to kind of look at your life and admit and say what's wrong. And in the beginning, we prayed, God, your resurrection power is so cool that you give us a fresh start. Remember that change starts with God, and admit what's wrong. Admit that, God, I've been living for me rather than for you. I've been putting myself first rather than putting you first. And say, God, help me. Help me. Forgive me and help me to change. Remember that first. Second, the big thing to remember. Here's where you can write some bullet points down. Remember that God's truth is truth. We talked about some of that today. It's going to push back against what we think, but it's God's truth is true. Here's a couple of big things that we've talked about today. That God's heart is generous. And he wants your heart to follow his. Here's another big thing we talked about. That everything that you have comes from God. All your time, your talent, your energy, your money, your balloons, they all can come from God. Where do you think they came from? God. All right? And then, by the way, it's like Walmart or something. But they come from God. And the third thing that we talked about is that God actually, those gifts that you got, all that talent, ability, God wants you to use it. God wants you to use those gifts. And he lets you use them for yourself. But here's the radical thing that Jesus pushes us toward, is he wants you to use those gifts for him. And to start there. Not to end there with what you got left over, but to start with what you got first and say, God, here's what I choose to give to you of my time. Here's what I choose to give to you of my money. Here's what I choose to give to you of my ability, etc. That he wants you to use it for him. And that as you do that, instead of like from the leftovers, what you're going to do is you're going to find yourself God's heart and grow in generosity like God is generous to you. So that's the first thing, remember. Second thing, make a plan. Actually make a plan. Now I see a few planners that are out there and a few guys that just kind of live by the seat of your pants. Neither way is wrong, but here, if you want to make progress, make a plan. Write it down. I hate writing stuff down. But if I don't write it down, it doesn't become reality. Okay? So I'm speaking to myself here. Make a plan. You know that old phrase, if you don't plan, if you fail to plan, right? If you fail to plan, what is that? I wrote it down. Yeah, if you fail to plan, then you plan to fail. Thank you. That's a long day. It's a long Sunday morning. If you, and that's true. I found this really cool verse this week. In Isaiah chapter 32, verse 8. I wrote it down so I remember it. Isaiah 32, verse 8, New Living Translation. Generous people plan to do what is generous, and they stand firm in their generosity. Let me read it again. Isaiah 32, verse 8, in the New Living Translation. Generous people plan to do what is generous, and they stand firm in their generosity. What's God saying here is, okay, make a plan. Decide what you're going to do. Okay? Doesn't say how much to do. He just says decide what you're going to do. Do it. That's the second step of the plan. And then the third step of the plan is stick with it even when it's hard. Because you can get some pushback, but he says they stand firm in their generosity. Now, here's where duty and obligation is going to help us a little bit. A good habit that we develop, because it's going to help us stick with it once we've said, okay, here's the plan, and now I start to do it, and I continue to do it, and I see that that's a habit or an obligation I've gotten into, and so I'm going to keep doing it. But it only takes us so far. Because if we just give up a duty or obligation, you know where that ends up? Usually ends up in a place like resentment, or stinginess, or grumpiness. And last time I read the Bible, I didn't see any of those as like spiritual gifts or spiritual fruits. But generosity is, and so for generosity, which is what Jesus wants us to do, it gets into where his heart is. And then we start to get in that spot like we were in that last game. We're giving and we're giving and we're giving and we're finding joy. Because we're finding joy because we discover there's joy in just the fact of giving. And we start to feel good about honoring God and doing what's right. And we start to find out as we're giving that God's actually faithful, that he does what he says, that God will make you rich enough so you can always be generous. And then we also start to discover when we're giving, we're actually doing some good. And as we're doing some good, we're creating opportunities to share about Jesus, and we're supporting the community that we've chosen to be a part of, and we're growing in faith and in faithfulness, and our heart is becoming more like God's.
Yeah.
That's a really good place to be. So let me give you some things you can start on with developing this plan as you're writing down a plan. The first part of the plan is to evaluate. Evaluate means you don't look and say, I'm giving 50% of myself when you're not, okay? Look and say, what am I giving of my time, of my energy, effort, of my ability, of my finances? What am I actually giving? And evaluate, is that where I want to be? Is that where God wants me to be? Or should I start to make some changes? The second step after you evaluate is to start to play, to take small steps. Some of you are already going to get this pushback from inside that says, no, give for yourself. And God's saying, no, I've given you this stuff, and you can use it to bless your life, but I want you to start with me. If you're not there, you need to start with small steps. If you try to leap from here to here, you're going to crash and burn. So take a little step. Let me talk about three big areas. Money. If you want to take a little step in giving generously in money, maybe a little step is to start by developing some sound financial practices. And some of those sound financial practices are simple things like, I'm going to spend less than I take in. Another sound financial practice is, you know, that credit card with 18 to 25% interest. I'm going to cut that unsecured credit card debt down because it's just steamrolling and it's not allowing me to be generous like I want to be generous. Another part of the plan is saying, just I'm going to give to God first. I think there's a reason that in the story Jesus doesn't really mention the amounts required. He just says, I'm giving to you, now give something to me first. So I don't care financially. If you're not giving anything, start giving. To a cause of God that's close to your heart. It could be a dollar. Start with a dollar and say, God, that dollar, that's yours. And then I'll give the rest. It might be more than that. Take a little step. If you're not giving regularly, then start saying, oh God, I've been kind of inconsistent. How can I give regularly? And just say, what am I going to do for you first? And then take a step from there. With your time, well, none of us have enough time to do whatever we want. Do it. But we all got the same amount. So I encourage you to the same way you would say, I'm going to give a part of my money first. Take a part of your time and say, I'm going to give a part of my time. I'm going to schedule or budget my time. I'm going to plan my schedule. I'm going to start by planning my schedule with the things that are important to do first. And I'm going to make sure they get done. I want to suggest you make sure you schedule some rest times in there. You make sure you schedule some God times in there. How about your talent? I'm going to suggest a couple things you do is work on your health. Because if you take care of your health, you're actually going to be able to serve God longer and better. You'll probably live longer. So work on your health, and then work on developing your talent, whatever it is, no matter what your age is. Work on developing your talent, and then look at one thing you can do with it for God, and say, how can I do that this week? And then you start to monitor your progress. That's the third thing. You got the plan, you got the small, evaluate, you got the small steps, you monitor your progress. Use benchmarks to see how you're doing. Anybody been to a restaurant lately? Other than like Jack in the Box or something? And the bill comes, and your dad pays, probably not you. And they have this little line on the bottom that says, tip. Now the benchmark is saying, what? When you go out now, it's kind of a benchmark. If you're being adequate, you should be somewhere between 15 and 20%, right? That's kind of the benchmark for tipping. That just says, oh, how do you know that you're doing what's kind of expected? Guess what? God actually gives us a benchmark for time and talent and money and energy and effort. He says, I know some of you are math challenged, God says, so I'm going to give you easy math, 10%. 10%. You keep 90, I get 10. And just give me the 10 first. Now, it's not, my benchmark is, I want you to understand this, that a benchmark is a baseline. He's saying, if you're not there in any of those areas, shoot to get there. And again, you're going to get there, what I say, what kind of bet? Big steps or small steps? Small steps. Small step that you can find success and joy, and it builds momentum, okay? So take a small step. Now, if you get there at that 10%, does he say stop there? You don't have to. You might grow in generosity and keep giving more. It's a benchmark just to say, how's my progress? Time is, a job you might say is 40 hours a week. Now, a lot of people work longer than that, but let's just use 40 hours a week. So 10% of 40 hours a week is 4. So whatever you made it a goal to benchmark to get to, I'm using 4 hours in my week for God. Now, if you happen to come to group, there's one Friday night, that's about an hour. And if you happen to come in here on Sunday, an hour and 10 minutes, you're halfway there. Right? So that's part of using it for God. How about your talent? Guys, is there one thing that I'm good at? And can I use that one thing in one little place for you in one activity this week? And money, that's the hard one. The math is easy, the execution is really, really hard. Okay, some of those financial practices will help you get there. Plan if you're not there to take a step in that direction to make a change this week. You know what helped me? First thing that helped me is, you'll notice a little a box in your program that says automate, whether through your own name, or a concordia. When I decided to automate, I made the decision once that I was going to have once a month this chunk of money come out. I don't need to make that decision anymore. It's been made and it happens automatically that I've said, God, here's what I'm giving to you, and I'm giving it to you first. I would encourage you to do that because that will help you put God first and then go and evaluate the case. stopped and I kept that going. Sometimes when my income changes, I'll go back and I'll look and I'll go, oh, thank you, God, I'll give a little more. If it drops, it's the same sort of thing. Periodically evaluate where you are and then consciously decide in all those areas. This is the fourth step there. Consciously decide, I'm going to put God where?
First.
I'm going to put God first. God, I'm giving you a dollar, but I'm giving you a dollar. God, I'm giving you a five, but I'm giving you five. God, I'm giving you ten, but I'm giving you ten. Whatever it is, he gets that first. God, I'm giving you this part of my time, and I'm giving it to you first, and then I'll do with the rest. And guys, then ask God's help, because you can't do this by yourself. Say, God, help me change my heart and make me more like you. Did he say that with you? God, help me change my heart, make my heart more like you. Say it one more time. God, help me. God, change my heart, make my heart more like you. And he does. And he will. And then as that's all working, this week actually starts. Take these notes home with you. Thank you for being here today. Begin to work on those and practice them. Next week, we're going to be back for the last stage in this series on living graciously. That's something you don't want to miss.